Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to have all of you here with us. So once again, we have the privilege of having Pak Gita Wirjawan here with us, and he will be giving a lecture on. There are two very important topics here that he will share with us. The first one is about the decoupling era, in which he will introduce to us about the condition, the global condition regarding to, geopolitics and also economy in this COVID era. And the second topic is about, related to the first one, about leadership in, negotiation and conflicts, because we are living in So we are living in unprecedented times, difficult times, in which, there will be great potential of conflicts in the future. And leadership is one of the good leadership is one of the factors that might mitigate that. So without further ado, Pak Gita, I'd like to invite you to give your lecture.
Sure. Thank you, Fendri, and thanks everyone for joining in this morning. If we could maybe show the slides. I've got two sets of slides this morning. I'll go first with the slides on decoupling. Let's move on to the next page. I think it's safe to assume that there's a few characteristics or attributes that are likely to color what's going to be in the post-COVID era. If we can move on to the next page.
Is the Thucydides trap being showed, Pak?
No, I'm still seeing the cover page. If we could move on to the
a mistake in sharing it.
There's a few characteristics or attributes that we're likely to see going forward.
Could you see it now, Pak?
Yeah, I could see it. Is that the first page after the cover page?
No.
Okay, please. Let's stick with this. Yeah. Okay. As I've been saying in the past, and this is consistent with what I've been saying, the first would be that, I think quite easily in the next 2 to 3 years, we're going to see a continuation of a deceleration of growth or economic growth around the world. If maybe we could have people muted so that there is no noise in the background. And I think the deceleration of economic growth around the world is largely going to be by way of the drop, if not collapse, of aggregate demand. As we're seeing in Indonesia, as we're seeing in many places around the world that would have been affected by the COVID-19 virus. The second, I think, is the disruptions with regards to the global supply chain, which have caused production and productivity to decline as we speak today, and as we are likely to see in the near foreseeable future. And this, I think, will have, you know, implications on, you know, importation of goods and services, you know, by many countries. As we've seen in the last couple of months, Indonesia's imports have declined, and that's largely because of, you know, the drop in demand, but also to a lot of extent, the drop in production and productivity in the originating countries that are sending goods and services to Indonesia. And the third, I think, is basically the increasing trends or extents of borrowing being done at the national level and at the corporate level, at the individual level. We are seeing in Indonesia, I think, so many efforts that are being done by companies, even at the sovereign level and also at the individual levels, to basically restructure their pre-existing exposures with the banking system, but also with the possibility of getting additional working capital facilities so that they could actually, you know, pay salaries while the economic activities have come to a full stoppage or a partial stoppage. The fourth would be the shift from conventional wisdom to any business model that's going to be much more embracing of the virtual, if not digital, paradigm. We have seen basically in the last 3 months, share prices, if not market capitalizations of companies that are much more fully embracing of digital paradigm going up, as opposed to those traditional companies which would have been trafficking in atoms as opposed to in bytes. Their values basically having come down in the last 3 months. So I think the interesting observation here is that any business that's trafficking in bytes is likely to continue moving up in value as opposed to anything that's trafficking in atoms that's you know, likely to actually decline in value. And that's, I think, how money is going to you know, appreciate business models going forward. And that will, I think, have implications on the venture capital space vis-a-vis the private equity space for those that are interested in entrepreneurial space. I think the future is likely to be much more, you know, thick with venture capital activities, which are embracing the digital paradigm a lot more than the private equity space that has been basically embracing a lot more of the conventional wisdom or the non-digital space. The fifth, I think, would be that capital markets have basically jumped up a lot more than proportionally, you know, vis-a-vis the real economies. The real economies within the developed space, the developing space, and the underdeveloped space have really not grown in the last 3 months. Many actually have contracted. And this is contrary to the fact that, you know, capital markets around the world have actually gone up thanks to, you know, the money infusion by way of the quantitative easing policies that have been undertaken by many developed economies. There's easily, you know, $5 to $10 trillion worth of money that's been infused into the capital markets in the last 2 to 3 months. And unfortunately, as much as that money was supposed to be for, you know, the lower, if not lowest levels of the real economies, it has been trapped in the, you know, capital markets instruments. So it hasn't really trickled down. The sixth attribute would be, I think, a tendency for us to see a continuation of long period of low inflation, if not a deflationary environment in the near foreseeable future. This is, I think, partly because of how technologies have actually helped collapse costs in such a significant manner. You know, now, you know, more and more people are actually shopping through marketplaces as opposed to going to the traditional brick and mortar for purposes of basically saving money in the context of not having to travel, you know, in your car, in your motorcycle, in your whatever transportation mode. And you're likely to see even, you know, a better pricing for the goods and services that you're going to be buying through the marketplaces or digital marketplaces, as opposed to, you know, buying your goods and services through conventional wisdom. The second reason that's going to cause low inflation in the near foreseeable future is just simply, you know, the fact that there's going to be more and more savings by way of the demographic trends, you know, becoming older while the number of asset classes that can be invested, you know, remaining constant. So the cost of money is only going to come down. And, you know, by way of people getting older, they're not likely to be more consumptive. If any, they're actually likely to be less consumptive. So as a result of less propensity to consume, then there is likely to be, you know, inflationary pressure. The third factor that would affect low inflation period, I think, would be just, you know, simply quantitative easing that's going to basically put money to work more in the capital markets as opposed to the real economy. So as much as we're seeing a divorce between the capital markets and the real economies, as much as we're seeing, you know, money not being not trickling down to the lower levels of the economy, that's going to cause a deceleration of the growth of consumption for people at every level of the real economy. The next attribute that's going to color would be the increasing polarization between China and the United States. And indirectly, I think this is going to dovetail into, you know, increased protectionism, not only within China and within the United States, but I think within more and more countries. And I've argued in the past that, you know, polarization of conversations is largely attributable to not only the geopolitical stands amongst the superpowers or between the superpowers, but it is also correlated, if not attributable, to the increase in inequality in many countries around the world, inclusive of those in the developed economies and also the developing economies. Now, if we could go to the next page. Next. This is what I call the Tersedia's trap. And Tersedia's trap essentially means that, you know, there is an incline of a new power, while there is a decline or seeming decline of a pre-existing superpower. And if we take a look at the global economies, you know, for the first, 1800 years, in the two millennia, the global economy would have been dominated by the economies of Asian countries, you know, namely China and India. And then there was an aberration for about 200 years where China's economy and India's economy dropped significantly thanks to colonialism. And then in the last, you know, decade or two, the Asian economies, predominantly India's and China's, have climbed up again. And as we see, the chart here, the global economy is already being dominated by Asian economies, namely India's and China's. And this is an illustration on a PPP adjusted basis. Whereas if we were to look at it on a nominal basis, the China's economy is still below that of the US economy. China's economy is still at $14 trillion. Vis-a-vis the United States economy at about $22 trillion. But on a PPP adjusted basis, China's economy is already in excess of that of the United States. So what we're seeing right now on a PPP adjusted basis is that, you know, Asian economies are dominant again, like we would have seen in the 17th century and before. So this is really not unprecedented. And this is, I think, causing nervousness within the U.S. and other countries that are likely to be, you know, affiliated or in alliance with the United States. So this trap, I think, has been reflected in three sort of like polarizations. And the first one would have been, you know, with respect to economic warfare between China and the United States. And the second would be with respect to information warfare, as we have seen cyber attacks being done by each upon each other. And I think the third possibility is some sort of a kinetic, you know, military activity between the two countries. We are seeing some movements, you know, being done by both sides. We're seeing China being more or showing more military activities in the South China Sea. And also on the border with India, and they've articulated some rhetoric with respect to a non-peaceful reunification with Taiwan, and some naval activities in the sea waterway between Japan and China. While the United States has also, you know, tried to show a bit more presence in the South China Sea, we are made aware of, I think, 2 to 3 aircraft carriers that are already maneuvering around the South China Sea. So I think we're likely to see more of this in the near foreseeable future. And this is only going to complicate lives, if not livelihood, for a lot of people around the world. So this is the kind of trap that, you know, we're seeing between the two countries. And I think, unfortunately, Indonesia is inevitably, you know, trapped in this sort of like geopolitical conflict between two superpowers. If we can go to the next page. This is a reflection of how China's ambition to not only become the largest economy around the world, but to actually be an influencer of ideology, an influencer of economy, an influencer of culture and all that. But I think to some extent, you've got to look at it from certain angles. I think from a GDP standpoint, they're becoming stronger than ever. But if we take a look at their current account, after 30 years of surpluses, their current account, you know, on an unusual and unprecedented basis, you know, went through a deficit last year in 2019. And I think we can safely assume that in 2020, by way of the deceleration of growth around the world, if not contraction of economic growth around the world, we're likely to again see a deficit scenario in the current account of China. And on the bottom chart here, we see how the Chinese currency or renminbi, you know, has not been able to move up the needle you know, much in the last, you know, 20 to 30 years, you know, in the context of international transactions. It still represents about 1.65% of all international cross-border transactions, while the United States dollar still represents around 42 to 43% of all international transactions, and the euro still represents around 33% of all international transactions. So I do believe that, you know, if China were to exercise its soft power around the world a little bit more than before, I think it needs to make sure that, you know, it sits again on a current account surplus, and it would be able to move the needle from 1.65% in terms of the usage of the renminbi to a much higher percentage in order for them to, you know, be able to export capital in a much more efficient and effective manner. Let's go to the next page. This is a reflection of how the two countries between, you know, the United States and China are increasingly levered. Their debt to GDP, you know, is at more than 300% if you take into account the private debt, the household debt, and the public debt. So they're not, they have a lot of debts on their shoulders. And if you take a look at the right side of the chart here, on the top right chart, it basically reflects, you know, comparison between, you know, China and the United States in terms of their energy production and consumption. We can see that, you know, the United States seems to be more energy sufficient on the bottom chart there. Their consumption and their production on a per capita basis are almost at equal level, whereas with respect to China, China still has a deficit, if not shortage, of energy, you know, availability on a per capita basis. So they need to figure out how to, you know, effectively and efficiently energize themselves in the future. Until today, I think they're still largely dependent on importation of energy sources from outside, from Indonesia, from the Middle East, from Australia, and from other places. And at the bottom right chart, it also reflects upon how basically the agricultural production vis-a-vis consumption, you know, for China. And we can see that, you know, the United States and China do not compare well, in the sense that the United States has more food availability on a per capita basis than China on a per capita basis. Next page. This is a reflection of how inequality has spread to many places. But if we take a look at the United States, on the right hand side, we've got those, you know, red, you know, lines on the left, and on the right, we've got some yellow and some white. Essentially, this is what I call the great disconnect between how, you know, financial assets and the capital markets have gone up since 2009, vis-a-vis how economies have gone up. And this is the point that I've been making over and over, in that the wedge or the gap between financial asset inflation and real economy inflation has basically, you know, increased inequality in the United States. I think, you know, there's some statistics that say that, you know, the bottom 50% of the people in the United States have actually gotten poorer than 20 to 30 years ago. And as a result, their Gini coefficient ratio has gone up to about 47%, you know, as of late, vis-a-vis China's at 49 and Indonesia at 39. So China and the United States, you know, have a widening inequality scenario. And this, I think, will dovetail into how they're going to be able to maintain social and political stability in the near foreseeable future, if not in the long run. They've got to make sure that this ratio comes down over time. They've got to make sure that the people at the bottom of the pyramid have access to food more than before. Unless and until they do that, I think there's going to be, you know, internal issues within the social equation and political equation of two countries. And that's going to complicate you know, matters, and it's going to complicate and make it more difficult for both sides to be able to resolve conflict. Indonesia, unfortunately, also sits with a Gini coefficient of around 39, which is rather high, but it's not as high as that in China and the United States. And there is also a widening gap between the inflation of financial assets in Indonesia and the inflation of real economy in Indonesia. So next page. Next. So essentially, what do we have to do? I really look at, you know, investment and tourism as the low-hanging fruits for Indonesia in order for Indonesia to actually project a much better soft power in the context of a much more complicated world, geopolitically speaking here. And I see an opportunity for Indonesia to actually leverage off digitization to increase financial inclusion. The financial inclusion in Indonesia has gone up, but it's still not about 50%. It's still at 49%. The access to capital in Indonesia is still far below than the level that we're seeing in countries like Singapore, Malaysia, and Thailand. And that, I think, is going to affect, you know, our ability to basically usher more equality in the near foreseeable future. And the third would be, you know, the marginal productivity, as I've, you know, iterated many times over in the past. And this is something that we've got to be able to address. I think in a more complicated geopolitical scenario, it is far more important than ever for Indonesia to actually increase its marginal productivity so that we can actually, you know, be a winner, at least in a regional context. And last would be, you know, the Gini coefficient ratio that has not gotten better in the last 5 to 10 years for the three countries of the United States, China, and Indonesia. So in a nutshell, there is, you know, a concern. There is, you know, a worrying situation by way of the increased polarization between the United States and China, but there is a real opportunity for Indonesia to actually bring in, you know, international money for purposes of investments and also tourism. And tourism has been hardest hit sector as we speak, and I don't see it recovering in the near future, but I see it as a sector that I think is going to be able to help bring in foreign exchange, you know, at least in the medium term and the long term. And I see digitization as a real opportunity for us to basically increase financial inclusion and to make ourselves much more relevant in at least in the Southeast Asia context, if not broader. Next. This is a chart that I've shown. I've expanded it a little bit more. If we go to the third column of marginal productivity, Indonesia sits at a marginal productivity of around $23,000 to $24,000, whereas Singapore and Brunei are sitting at around $140,000 to $150,000 on a per capita basis. There's a lot of work to be done. And if you put this in the context of the, you know, economic recovery plan by the government, I think the more reason we've actually got to be much more bold in, you know, increasing the stimulus amount, so that not only can we preserve the competitive advantage, but we could actually increase the competitive advantage at the rate that we're not actually stimulating the economy as much on a relative and on a nominal basis vis-a-vis Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, and Vietnam and the Philippines. I think it is likely that, you know, in the next couple of years, Indonesia's competitive advantage is going to be even less than it is today, because Singapore is allocating, you know, 20% of their GDP for the economic recovery. Malaysia around 20%. Vietnam, Thailand, and the Philippines between 8. Asia is spending on 2.4 GDP. It is likely to move the needle to about 3.9% of the GDP for the 3.0. Can we still stick? Okay, let's stick here. And I think it is a concern in that we're not spending as much as we should, and we're not spending as much as the neighboring countries. This will quite seriously in the next couple of years. I foresee a future where, at the rate that Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, and Vietnam are spending more than we are on a relative basis, I foresee a future where I think Singapore is even going to be more sophisticated in embracing the digitization, and it's going to be more sophisticated in basically serving as the hub for financial services for the region. And I foresee a future where I think Thailand and Vietnam are going to be even more sophisticated and stronger in serving as the manufacturing basis for Southeast Asia, as opposed to Indonesia. At the rate that Indonesia is not going to be able to move the marginal productivity to a much higher level in the near foreseeable future, I think Indonesia runs the risk of losing out to Singapore, Thailand, and Vietnam, unless it changes its policy posture in a significant manner. And let's hope that that would happen soon. Next. Oh, sorry. If we could go back to the earlier page. The last column is basically reflective of the broad money. If we take a look at the broad money, that's essentially M2, amount of circulation. The broad money in Indonesia is only around 38, as the ASEAN countries are more for the most part. In Indonesia, vis-a-vis the GDP is not as much as we're seeing in other countries in Southeast Asia. The concern for a hyperinflationary environment is actually misplaced. I'm not concerned at all about, you know, any potential risk of hyperinflation in Indonesia, as has been articulated by some people in the country, if we were to even consider doing quantitative easing, especially if we were to prevent the spending of the money for investments or capital expenditures. If we were to focus money for food, focusing of the money for essential, and at the rate that the broad money is only at 38% of the GDP, the risk for inflation or hyperinflation I think is almost completely misplaced. And we have seen it in the first quarter that the inflation was only at 2.96%, as compared to what people might have referred to, you know, as a hyperinflation. Next page. So this is the stimulus package that's being done by, okay, if we could mute, I'm seeing background noise or hearing background noise in the back. Okay, now if we take a look at the comparison here, Indonesia is spending about 2.5% of the GDP for stimulus purposes, Vietnam at 5.1, Philippines at 8.5, Thailand 11.2%, Singapore at 19%, Malaysia at 20%. So you know right here, okay, Thailand and Vietnam, I think they're going to stand out as the future manufacturing basis for ASEAN. And they're going to be able to take advantage of the free trade agreement between ASEAN and the rest of the world, so that if they were to build a manufacturing base in Thailand or Vietnam, you know, they're not going to be, you know, charge any tariff for basically exporting or sending any goods and services to other parts of Southeast Asia. And Singapore, by way of their spending, you know, 19% of the GDP for stimulus purposes, they're going to stand out in terms of embracing the digital space and also being a much more sophisticated financial service base. And I think Indonesia runs the risk here of basically, you know, even moving behind the line unless, you know, it spends a lot more than the 2.5% of the GDP. If we take a look at the breakdown of the spending between social safety nets and small, medium enterprises and corporates, I think we can congratulate the Indonesian government for basically paying attention to, you know, the, you know, social safety net and also the small, medium entrepreneurs. The main difference between today and the previous, you know, crises in 2008 and 1998 would be that in 1998 and 2008, the small, medium entrepreneurs were the ones that were actually resilient and kept the economies alive. Whereas today, it is the small, medium entrepreneurs that are actually getting much more hit by the crisis, you know, than ever, even, you know, compared to the larger corporations. Next page. So again, this is the FDI picture. If we take a look at the last 3 years, 2017, 2018, 2019, FDI has pretty much dropped. And if we take a look at the last 6 years, from 2014 or 2013 even, you know, it's pretty much been plateauing. It hasn't really picked up. And I think a much more interesting statistic is if we take a look at the bottom part of the chart, Singapore is able to attract FDI on a per capita basis. So basically, you divide the FDI that comes into a particular country by the population of that country. Singapore is able to attract more than $18,000 per person of FDI per year. Okay, whereas Vietnam is, or Malaysia is able to attract close to $300. Vietnam close to $200. And Philippines attracting around $91. Okay, it is a fact that I think we've got to be familiar with, in the sense that we cannot afford to be attracting FDI of only $91 per capita. You know, at the rate that Singapore has been able to attract $18,000 to $19,000 per person, we've got to be able to ramp up the $91 per capita per year to a much larger figure. And this is going to improve not only our ability to create jobs in the country, but this is going to help our ability to create better and higher quality jobs. And this is going to help us basically bring down inequality if we were to be able to ramp up the FDI per capita from $91 to a much higher level. And this is something that I think we've got to basically work on much more seriously going forward if we were to compete. Until and unless, you know, we really don't want to be competitive in the future. And I do think that Indonesia, being the largest economy, the largest population in Southeast Asia, I think it needs to be getting a much larger number of FDI on a holistic basis, but also on a per capita basis. I want to highlight that as much as the Philippines is only getting around $91 to $92 of FDI per capita, but they've been able to succeed in bringing extra money from overseas by way of the repatriation of money from their foreign workers. The Philippines, or the Filipinos and Filipinas who are working in many places, including Hong Kong, Singapore, the Middle East, and the United States and Europe, as nurses, as receptionists, as IT specialists, as doctors, lawyers, and all that, they bring in about $35 billion a year. And this is a lot of foreign exchange as compared to Indonesia's or Indonesian foreign workers. The Indonesians that work in Singapore, Malaysia, the Middle East, and other in Hong Kong and other places, they only bring in $11 billion per year. So it is a much lower number than what the Filipinos and Filipinas are bringing in. In addition to the $35 billion that the Filipinos are bringing back on a yearly basis, the Filipinos are also empowered by many of the multinational companies to basically operate in call centers. And the call center activities, being done by the Filipinos, bring in about $28 to $30 billion. So if we take a look at the FDI of the Philippines, we've got to add the $35 billion that's brought back by the Filipino workers and the $28 to $30 billion that's being produced by the Filipinos that are working in call center facilities. And those numbers are just much bigger compared to whatever foreign dollars that the Indonesians are bringing in. Next. This is the Gini ratio table that basically shows the difference between China, the United States, and Indonesia. The United States Gini ratio is at 49, China is at 47, and Indonesia is at 39. These are, I think, worrying signs in terms of how they can actually maintain political and social stability within their own countries. And I do believe that, you know, by way of creating more jobs in the country or in each country, by way of creating more high quality jobs in each country, I think each country is going to be able to basically bring down inequality, bring down, uncertainties and instability. And they're going to be able to thrive, as a going concern or on a sustainable basis. And this will, I think, if we take a view on bringing down the Gini ratio in Indonesia and also in China and also in the United States, this, I think, will help depolarize any polarization that we might be seeing today. Next. Okay. So I've talked about the decoupling and how the decoupling has and is to continue, I think it's not easy at the rate that the information warfare, the economic warfare, and potentially some sort of a kinetic activity and counter activity by both countries will further complicate the polarization, and that's going to actually make life a little bit more difficult. And in terms of conflict resolution, I only see, in the long term, the conflict being resolved by way of, each side basically making sure there is some sort of a view taking on what I call a mutually assured destruction. If we were to go back to the Cold War between the Soviets and the Americans until 1989, there was a sense of a mutually assured destruction, in the sense that if one side were to basically launch its nuclear head or warhead, we can that and
You're a bit choppy, but the sound.
Basically, a nucleus. Sorry, Fendry, what did you say?
Yeah, the sound is a bit choppy from my place.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh, okay. Can you hear me better now? Can you hear me better?
Yeah, I can, but yeah.
Okay. All right. Now, I was talking about a mutually assured destruction concept, which we saw during the Cold War. Is that better now, Fendry? Can you hear me?
Yes, but much better.
Okay. All right. As we saw during the Cold War between the Soviets and the Americans, to the extent that there was an understanding by each side that if they were to launch a nuclear warhead, it would be a lose-lose proposition, not only for both sides, but also for everybody around the world. And I think that there's some sort of an understanding now between China and the U.S. That there could be a mutually assured destruction if they were to make things worse, economically speaking, or even information-wise, that it would be a lose-lose proposition not only for both sides, but it would be a lose-lose proposition for everybody around the world. And I hope that that sense of mutually assured destruction in the context of the polarity between the United States and China would basically preserve the calm and preserve the peace, so that everybody else around the world would be able to thrive and continue operating. If we could go to the conflict resolution set of pages. Next. Now let's. I'm not trying to make life even more complicated here, but if we take a look at the global map of the COVID-19, there is more than 8 million people that have been infected, and there is more than 400,000 people dead around the world, with a mortality rate of 5.4%. And I think the highest mortality rates that we're seeing would be in places like Spain, Italy, and France, and also the UK. Whereas the United States and China are maintaining mortality rates at around 5 to 6%, similar to what Indonesia's mortality rate is. Indonesia is looking at a total infection of around 40,000, with the number of deaths exceeding 2,000 recently, with a mortality rate of about 5.5%. But the recovery rate is still at around 34% in Indonesia, and this I think is sort of like a conflict situation that nobody anticipated 4 or 5 months ago, and I think this is sort of like a warfare situation where we actually do not know where the enemy is, and I think as much as we think of this as an economic crisis, as much as we think of this as actually a health crisis, I actually would like to think of this as an information crisis. It is an information crisis in the sense that we don't know whether or not and the extent to which we're going to be infected by the guy that's actually standing next to me or next to us. And we don't know whether or not, the next day we're going to be exposed to, the virus or what. And I think that inability to actually know or basically size up what we have to do causes a lot of uncertainty, and uncertainty is the biggest enemy to any economy, to the extent that the business community within the economy needs to be able to mitigate the risks of uncertainties, needs to be able to manage uncertainties, and at the rate that it's not able to manage uncertainties as well as it has been able in the past, it causes a huge discount to business activities, to economic activities. And I think this is likely to prevail for the near foreseeable future. And if you put that in the context of how we can negotiate our way out of this conflict, I think it's going to be very difficult. It is not like the typical negotiation that we've been able to do, whether it's in social enterprise or business enterprise or public enterprise. I think it is completely unprecedented because of our inability to size up and quantify information as well as before. In a typical negotiation, leadership is evident. in the sense that the leadership is able to basically quantify and size up the relevant information so that he or she could actually size up the number of steps and the kinds of steps that he or she needs to take in order to be able to, number one, show empathy for the other side, number two, to be able to speak in the language that touches the heart of the other side, and basically not only be reactive but be proactive in prescribing a proposed framework that would be win-win for both sides. Whereas in this case, we are seeing a diminution of leadership at the regional level and at the global level. To put concretely, even in the context of ASEAN, we have seen in the last 3 months, I think, each country basically moving in their own direction as opposed to a collective direction that would have been basically influenced by collective decision making. And at the global level, we have seen the G7, we've seen the G20 having met, one or two times, but not really deciding, on a collective basis for the benefit of the collective, for the benefit of the collective good, as opposed to, the individual good. And I think this is, complicating, the nature of the conflict that needs to be resolved, not only at the national individual level, but also at the regional and at the global levels. So this is the new kind of negotiation that we have to undertake, as opposed to, trying to negotiate to get a better deal on your next motorcycle purchase, trying to get the next best deal on a climate, change proposition, or on a merger of two companies and all that. We have talked about, in the past, how we could actually sort out a negotiation on climate. We believe that the Paris Accord was going to be able to be a game changer in the sense that by the year 2030, all countries around the world are going to be able to comply to the new proposed framework so that, we can actually live, on a sustained basis. But this COVID-19 scenario, I think, is going to complicate a few more things that will actually cause us to be more, hopefully, wise, that will cause us to be more pragmatic in trying to figure out a solution, if not resolution, to the conflict that we're seeing. So, net-net, if I could sum up before I take questions, the world is getting slightly more complicated because of a deceleration of economic growth, because of a decrease of productivity, because of the divergence between the rich and the poor, because of the polarization between the two superpowers in the world. Indonesia, in order to be able to negotiate its way out of the COVID-19 crisis, I think needs to be able to size up information in a much more efficient, much more effective, much more judicious manner in order to be able to take the necessary bold, timely, relevant, targeted approach so that we could actually get out of this and with an end game in the near foreseeable future, in the medium term and the long term, as a potential leader in marginal productivity, as a potential leader and competitive advantage in the context of ASEAN or Southeast Asia, so that we could actually really actualize the aspiration of becoming the fourth or fifth largest economy in the world by the year 2040 to 2045. Let me end right there and take questions.
Thank you, Pak. So for any of you guys who have questions that you would like to ask, please raise your hand and then I'll let you guys speak. But before that, Pak Gita, I'd like to ask about something. You mentioned that the world is going to be more polarized, and that in the near future, there will be much more friction, geopolitically speaking. And for Indonesia, in the context of Indonesia, what do you think is needed? I mean, what kind of leadership do you think do you foresee that Indonesia needs to, you know, in the near future?
Look, I think, again, I say this like a broken record. It starts off with handling the information crisis, right? And I've been saying this in the past that in order for us to make the right kind of decision with respect to the health crisis, we've got to know better. We've got to know more. And I don't think we know enough about the health crisis. We're only testing around 1,400 per 1 million people. Okay, I've said it a few times in the past webinars, whether it's SGPP or other webinars, we're only testing around 1,400 people per 1 million. Singapore and the United States have tested around 65,000 to 70,000 per 1 million. Malaysia and Korea have tested around 18,000 per 1 million. I'm of the view that we're not going to be able to know or better, we're not going to be better informed unless we test at least 5 to 10,000 per 1 million people. Now, when we get there, I think we know a little bit better and we have a little bit more information about where the epicenter is and how we deal with the epicenter and where there is no epicenter of pandemic, right, or transmission. Now, I think it's a crisis of information that could actually be overcome by way of getting more information. I don't think it's a case of being misinformed, but it's a case of being underinformed. And the case of being underinformed could easily be remedied by getting more information. Once we get more information by way of testing a lot more people than before, then we can size up how we're going to treat those that are more infected than others. Now, once we do that, then we can size up how we're actually going to allow the health crisis dovetail into the economic crisis, or how we can actually resolve the health crisis and how the resolution of the health crisis could actually have an effect on how we resolve the economic crisis. Now, once we quantify the health crisis, then I think we can quantify the economic crisis. And I'm of the view that quantifying it at 2.5% of the GDP for stimulating the economy is the lowest. And enrich Asia. So I think the leadership that's required here is really in the context of getting more information and transmitting the information on a real time, on a transparent and inclusive basis, so that we could actually quantify, you know, the health crisis and the economic crisis. I'm of the view that, you know, I think there is open-mindedness in the government. You know, we've been saying this over and over like a broken record, but I'm of the view that I think the posture or the policy posture of the government is changing towards, you know, what we have been saying, you know, since 3 to 4 months ago. It might be late, but I think it's better, you know, being late than never.
Okay, Bagita, would that also trickle down into, you know, how we, you know, take a stance in the global geopolitics? I mean, whether we need
absolutely.
To...
Absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. Look, I mean, if we were to remedy our economy effectively and properly, right, we're going to stand out. We're going to stand out like maybe Taiwan. We're going to stand out like, you know, I mean, you know, a lot of people have underrated Greece. Okay, it's economically pretty defunct, but it has been able to basically come around the COVID-19 crisis much better than most other, you know, Western European countries. And that, I think, is a real thumbs up for Greece. You know, let's not forget, you know, they went through a pretty massive economic crisis some years ago. And they've been able to basically show resilience with respect to the COVID-19. Taiwan is another great example. And I think for a while, people thought Singapore was doing really well until the eruption, you know, involving the foreign workers in the dorms. But I think, you know, they learned and they've been able to basically repurpose. And by way of repurposing, they've been able to, you know, basically come out of the hole with better controls. So I do think that if we can spend at least 10% of the GDP for purposes of the stimulus, I think we've got a real chance at maintaining our competitive advantage, if not even augmenting our marginal productivity and competitive advantage. And we could stand out in the next 2 to 3 years. And you know, multinational companies are going to want to put more money to work in Indonesia, you know, for purposes of building factories, for purposes of, you know, digitizing, for increasing our financial inclusiveness, and for purposes of other things that are going to make ourselves a little bit, you know, more nimble, more, you know, effective in positioning ourselves geopolitically. And the easiest way to basically project soft power is to be able to bring in a lot more than 15 million tourists to Indonesia. Indonesia brought in only 15 million tourists, as opposed to Thailand bringing in 40 million tourists, Malaysia 25 million tourists, Singapore 21 to 22 million tourists. And we're a lot larger than Thailand, Malaysia, and Singapore. I mean, if we could bring in 50 to 100 million tourists, you know, number one, we're going to be able to bring in a lot more foreign exchange. Number two, a lot more people are going to know about us. Sure, they're going to know maybe about the negative stuff about us, but I think they're going to know a lot about the positive stuff, you know, about Indonesia. And that's how you get people to be familiar with Indonesia. So if more and more people are familiar with Indonesia, not just in the context of earthquakes, tsunamis, or poverties, but in the context of things that are really cool, I think we're going to be able to project, you know, the kind of soft power that's maybe, you know, could help mediate, you know, superpowers like China and the U.S. In the medium and long term. So that's I think, a real possible future for Indonesia. And I think we got to start thinking like that. More and more of us have to start thinking like that. It's not an impossibility, but that possibility could actually be actualized if we actually, you know, improve in our storytelling capabilities.
Got it. Thank you, Pak. So we have Jeffy here who would like to ask a question. Go ahead, Mas Jeffy, if you could turn on your video as well.
Okay. Thank you, Pak. Thank you, Pak Fendry. Good morning, Pak Gita and everyone. Thank you for giving an incredible presentation. This is me, Jeff, from Basics. Actually, I would like to ask you about the first question is about, based on your previous slide that you mentioned, direct investment from outside to Indonesia per capita is $91.3 US dollar in 2019. So if we compare with other countries, we still have the lowest FDI per capita. So my question is, in your opinion, what is the best solution to increase FDI of Indonesia? That is my first question. And for the second question is, how to increase the marginal productivity in order to compete with another country? Okay, thank you so much, Pak Gita.
Look, increasing FDI requires storytelling. Right. I've been saying this like a broken record. We've got a real great narrative. We are the third largest democracy or the fourth most populous in the world. We're demographically young like the Indians. Okay. Imagine how those young people could actually be empowered for purposes of producing and becoming productive. Right. And somebody needs to tell this story. Somebody needs to be, and it can't just be one person. I think it needs to be a group of people from Indonesia. And I hope to God you guys could be the next narrators who could actually tell the story to the world that, look, it's not just about, you know, volcanic eruptions, tsunamis, and earthquakes, but it's about being able to actually thrive as a democratic country, which will hopefully bring about, you know, good for more people than not in the region and in the world. And we're next to India and the United States in terms of being democratic, but we've got to make sure that democracy actually sustains. And how do we sustain or preserve democracy on a sustainable basis? We've got to be able to create jobs, and we can only create jobs if we bring in the money Now, we don't have to get FDI if we have a lot of money domestically. But the sad part is that we don't have a lot of money domestically. So we've got to get money from overseas. And the real mockery is that there is a lot of liquidity that's sitting in the periphery. I've been saying this before, that there is about $100 trillion worth of liquidity that's floating around. But we've got to basically make sure that we're nimble. You know, I like to embrace the water philosophy. You know, we have to behave like water. We've got to be flexible. We've got to be nimble. And we've got to treat money as water, because water behaves in accordance to gravitational forces. And the gravity within the money sense basically means that, you know, we've got to be welcoming. You know, we've got to be gravitationally welcoming of money. And you're not going to welcome any gravitational push or pull if we don't go out there and tell the story. And if we don't make sure that, you know, the investment climate in Indonesia is welcoming. And we've got to make sure that, you know, law enforcement works. If we say A on the ground, it actually is A. We can't just continue saying A, but on the ground it's B, C, or even H. And that, I think, compares differently with what the experience or the user experience is in places like Vietnam and Thailand. And I think that's the first thing that you ought to do to ramp up the $91 of FDI on a per capita basis. I really think we can ramp that up to like $500 to $1,000 on a per capita basis. If we've got 10 to 20 people that can actually utter the story in the right way. And you've got to be able to do it in English. You can't do it in non-English, because unfortunately people, you know, around the world, or most people around the world, only understand English. You know, and the money, the liquidity sits in places where people only speak English. And most of this $100 trillion sit in the United States and Western European countries. And it's actually being managed by around 17 companies only. You know, so, you know, the transnational investment firms, they make up about 17 companies, and only 200 people sit on the boards of these 17 companies, and they all speak only one language. It's called English, which is why we've got to be able to communicate in English, you know, a little bit better, so that we can get and draw this money back to this country, so that we can actually put that money to work, so people could actually, you know, get jobs. And number two, how do we ramp up marginal productivity? We can only ramp up productivity if people have access to money, right? If people and more people have access to money, then they could actually do things a little bit more productively. And you basically work on the digitization of financial services, so people could have more access to money, so that the financial inclusion goes up from 49%. To hopefully 80%. And that's doable if you bring in the technology, if you bring in the money, and if you bring in the natural, I mean, the human resources. Look, at the end of the day, a leadership in a corporate setting, a leadership in a national setting, a leadership at any kind of setting, basically needs to be able to properly allocate capital. And that capital could be human capital or financial capital. We've got to get the financial capital, and we've got to actually get the human capital. And I think we've got to recognize that if our human capital is actually numerous, that's great. But if it's numerous only, but it's not basically applicable to the technological transfer that's coming in from overseas, we've got to show open-mindedness to bring in the human capital from overseas, so that there could actually be technological transfer, you know, from the new human capital from overseas to the human capital within the country. That is really how you make it work. So you can increase the FDI per capita from $91 to a much larger number by bringing the dough, only if you know how to communicate with the right people that have access to money. Number two, you can actually bring up the marginal productivity from $23,000 to, let's say, $100,000 or potentially $150,000, like Singapore, if you get more and more people to have access to money. And the only quick way to do that is to digitize financial services as quickly as possible.
Okay, Jeff.
Yes, Pak. Thank you so much, Pak Gita.
Okay, so Pakita, there's a question from Ibe, one of our students from batch 6. In regards to this decoupling, this is similar to what I asked. How could Indonesia negotiate its position to the U.S. while seemingly inclined to China? And how could Indonesia
Could you repeat that again?
In regards to the decoupling issue, Pak, how should Indonesia negotiate its position to the United States while seemingly being inclined to China? And how could Indonesia negotiate her position to Japan, India, and South Korea regarding this decoupling?
Look, I just wrote a commentary a few days ago to basically underline the point that we've got to exercise wisdom and pragmatism in the context of this decoupling. And I think wisdom is reflected in our basically being or embracing of the paradigm, 1,000 friends and 0 enemy. I do think it is wise for us to actually be friends with everybody, including China and the United States. We cannot afford to be dragged into the corner where we're siding with one side over the other, simply because we do not know how all this is going to end up, right? And pragmatic in the sense that we've got to know where the real money is going to come from. And I've kind of like showed the chart. And money is only going to come from countries that have a lot of liquidity, that have current account surpluses, right? And China has gone through a current account deficit. The current account is basically the source for exportation of capital, right? Of international money. Right? To the extent that any country does not have a current account surplus, it's going to not have international money that can be exported. It's going to have local money that can be exported, but you've got to make sure that that local money is going to be acceptable in the international market. And I made the point that the acceptability of that local money in China is only at 1.65%. But this is not to say that we shouldn't be dealing with China. I do foresee a future where China is going to be able to digitize in a much more significant manner their local money for transactions around the world, be it through, you know, the platforms of Alibaba or Baidu or Tencent. And I think that's going to happen. But how long will it take? I have no idea. Okay. And at the same time, the United States is also sitting on a current account deficit. Okay. It doesn't seem to have a lot of capacity to export money because it's sitting on a deficit, you know, on a current account deficit. But it's been printing a lot of dollars and it's got lots of liquidity in the hands of, you know, money managers. And at the rate that the world is still in love with the United States dollars, because 43 to 44% of international transactions are still being done in U.S. dollars. So we've got to accept the fact that, you know, it's still a popular currency. And, you know, if we want to basically move forward, we've got to basically bring in any currency that's acceptable internationally. And unfortunately or fortunately, the United States dollar is still a popular currency. So I think we've got to basically be pragmatic, about stuff like that. And I think we've got to be able to send a bunch of storytellers to those people that are actually in control or in management of the $100 trillion so that maybe a little bit of that could come here. When a little bit of that comes here, more will come. And when more will come, we'll be able to ramp up the $91 of FDI per capita to a much larger level, and we'll be able to bring in that money into situations that are going to improve financial inclusion so that we can actually ramp up marginal productivity. So I think we've got to basically be close to both sides in essence. And other countries that are siding with either of the two sides, you know, we're going to have to be close with those two. You know, be it, you know, Venezuela or South Korea, Japan, or anyone.
Thank you, Pakita. But yeah, it's going to be very tricky then, Pak, in terms of negotiation and trying to keep ourselves neutral in regards to the, you know, being pulled to one polar or the other.
Yeah, it is. Look, I've told this story of the wise woman. The wisdom of a wise woman cannot be underestimated. Okay,
this story about this old man who's dying, who's got three kids, and the old man basically tells the three kids, look, kids, you know, I've got 17 horses. You know, you, the oldest, you're going to get, you know, one half. You, the second, you're going to get one third. You, the third, you're going to get one sixth. Right? And how the hell are you going to be able to divide 17 with two? How are you going to be able to divide 17 by three? And sorry, the third is going to get like one ninth. How do you divide 17 by nine? So the three kids, the three boys, they basically went to this old woman, you know, who's full of wisdom. And the old woman happens to have one horse. And she says, look, kids, why don't you take my horse and take it back to your daddy? And you know, you tell him, you know, you've got a solution. So the three of them went back to the father who's dying on the deathbed, on a dying bed. And, you know, the oldest goes, dad, you know, we've got it figured out. Now we've got 18 horses. I'm going to get nine. My younger brother is going to get six. And the youngest is going to get two. Right? So how do you add up? Nine plus six plus two. You get to what? 17. And you end up with one horse left. And the three kids, they take back the one horse left to the old lady. And the old lady gets to keep the old horse. And the three kids get to keep, you know, their, you know, proportional horses or respective horses. That's how you resolve conflict. You resolve conflict, you know, by way of engaging a mediator. And the mediator has got to have neutrality. The mediator has got to have wisdom. The mediator has got to have objectivity. And I hope to God that Indonesia could be that wise woman. Right, in the context of a decoupling between the United States and China, at the rate that, you know, we're a pretty large, you know, democracy. And I think it would be tougher for India to serve as a mediator because India is bordering with China and they're running into skirmishes at the border with China. So it's tough for them to be neutral as much as, you know, they can probably be helpful because of their scale, but they would be perceived as being a little too biased towards the United States. Whereas Indonesia has got enough, I think, independence, enough distance geographically, geostrategically, geopolitically. And you know, we should be a respected democracy by the United States and India, and we should be respected as an Asia Pacific, you know, country by China. So we could be the wise woman in the future, in the context of increased polarization between China and the United States.
Thank you, Pa. So there's another question, Pa, from Naomi, one of our students from batch 6. Thank you for the insight, Pa Gita. Earlier, you talked about Indonesia's FDI far compared to that of some ASEAN countries. What do you think is the most important thing now during the COVID-19 era for Indonesia to increase FDI, specifically in the COVID-19 era? And what about PE investment from abroad and local? Can it contribute to Indonesia's GDP growth? What about Indonesia's PE investment in COVID-19 right now?
Look, I think, you know, the government at the moment is cooking up what we call the omnibus law. And I'm quite optimistic that this is going to get done. At the rate that it's going to get done in the next couple of months, I'm hopeful that it could get done in July. If it could get done, I think it'll send the right message to the rest of the world in that we're open for business, right? Which is a good start. But I'm also sensitive to the fact that, you know, most countries around the world are more worried about themselves as opposed to other countries, right? Because they've got to solve and resolve their own domestic issues. But at least if we can reframe ourselves as a better place to invest by way of this omnibus, you know, you're likely to see an extension of the leasehold to 90 years. You're likely to see an opening up of the mining sector. You're likely to see an opening up of the, you know, the labor force. and much more flexibility in the labor force. You're likely to see, basically more open-mindedness in so many sectors that are relevant in creating jobs. At the end of the day, you know, people out there are going to be smart enough to know. And again, they're going to behave like water. And this is gravitationally okay, because with the reframing of the investment climate with the omnibus law, I think we're going to appear more attractive. Now, that's step one. Step two, we've got to send out troops that could actually tell the story, that could actually communicate in the right language, because, you know, every country out there is going to compete for FDI, right? And the Singaporeans, the Malaysians, the Thais, the Vietnamese, the Filipinos, the Cambodians, the Myanmarese, and the Bruneians and all the rest, they're going to be competing for the same finite dollars out there. So I think we've got to work hard, but knowing that, you know, we're working off a much better starting line, I think it's going to be good. So I foresee that maybe 2021, we're going to be able to attract quite significant amount of dollars if we have the right narrators to narrate our narrative.
Thank you, Pagita. Naomi, I hope that answered your question. For the next questioner, we have Payudi from our from Batch 6. Payudi, go ahead, Payudi.
Yes, thank you, Pak Henry. Thank you. Good morning, Pagita.
Morning.
Thank you, Pagita, for this explanation. That is quite clear, our position in this era of the coupling or issue of decoupling. There are several sources of conflict within an organization. In this case, I'm analogizing the state as a large of organization where there is territory, there are people, and there are leaders or governments. So as we know, four sources, the conflict are: one is communication factor, and second is task structure factor, and third is personal factor, and the last or four is environment factor. So in the past COVID-19, the world in general and Indonesia in particular will be colored by several attributes that have been conveyed by Pagita previously. So my question, Pagita, is related to the role of the Indonesian leadership in responding to post-COVID-19, which tend to be a conflict in terms of being not handled properly. So the question is, which factor are the dominant sources of conflicts? Thank you, Pagita.
Well, I mean, one could argue that the trust level of any partnership or association is affected by the credibility of not only decision making, but the credibility of information sharing, right? And I think I'd like to fundamentally raise the point that this crisis is really a crisis of information, right? And depending on the degree to which you can actually obtain information, depending on the degree to which you can actually share information, these, I think, would affect the degree to which you appear credible, right? Now, to the extent that you appear credible, then the trust level would be optimal, right? And I'm not saying that the government hasn't worked hard on getting the information. All I'm saying is I think the government needs to work a little bit harder in getting the right amount of information. And it starts with testing, right? And testing requires money, right? I've made the point that 75 trillion rupees that would have been allocated for healthcare purposes is not nearly enough for us to be able to size up the right kind of information. It has to be, I think, increased to 300 to 400 trillion so that we could actually be effective in obtaining the information. Once we get the information, then we can actually sum up, we can size up, right? How that actually affects the healthcare issue and how the healthcare issue affects the economic issue. So I think it's a series of things that affect credibility of, you know, the team and the leadership of anything or any country or any corporation or any setting or community even. And I do believe that, you know, people tend to, you know, they learn from past mistakes. You know, we've seen in the past how they actually missed out on the prediction with respect to the economic growth rate in the first quarter. They were, I think, quite, you know, optimistic until, you know, maybe April or me probably March that the first quarter result, you know, was going to yield an economic growth rate of around 4.5 to 4.7%. And when it turned out to be actually 2.96%, right? And when some policymakers were actually uttering that, you know, there is a risk of hyperinflation if we were to do quantitative easing, now it's clear that there was no risk of inflation nor hyperinflation because the inflation was only 2.97%, right? I've been basically saying since early February to many of my friends in the government and many of my friends in the academic domain that, you know, that the economy runs the risk or would run the risk of, you know, slowing down to 0% growth in 2020. At that time, people thought that I was crazy. People thought that I was hallucinating. People didn't think I was making any sense. But now I think more and more people are starting to say, you know, this guy makes, you know, some sense. And I've been saying since March, you were part of this audience in March when I basically made the point that, you know, perhaps at the rate that we're not going to have a lot of liquidity domestically, perhaps at the rate that we're going to have difficulty in getting liquidity from overseas, we may want to consider, you know, infusing liquidity quantitatively by way of doing quantitative easing, i.e. printing money. And thank God, you know, they came up with the perpu, which actually allows for the central bank to actually buy into the primary markets. That indirectly means that the central bank would be allowed to print money and, you know, be helpful to the recovery of the economy. Until today, the central bank has not printed money, to my knowledge. I could be wrong, but they have finally shown open-mindedness with the concept of quantitative easing. And the way they did that was to basically lower the reserve requirement. We call it in Indonesia, giro wajib minimum. So by lowering the reserve requirement, that is a quantitative easing exercise. And they've actually been active buying, you know, the repurchase instruments in the secondary market. That allows for some additional liquidity in the market, but it hasn't gone to the level that I would have thought I would have aspired for, because you know, in order to basically you know, allow for a full recovery on the demand side and also on the supply side. On the demand side, it's basically you know, getting money to people that have lost their jobs, including the barbers, including the manicurist, including the acupuncturist, including the therapist, including the singers, including the actors, including anybody that has been affected by immobility and anonymous interaction inability. They need to have money on the table so that they could buy food. That hasn't been reflected in the quantification of the recovery, you know, to the fullest extent. And on the supply side, and I've been saying on the supply side, we've got to make sure that the small, medium entrepreneurs, they've got to be able to restructure their loans at the banks. The small, medium entrepreneurs have a loan of about 1,100 trillion rupees. And then we've got to make sure that the BUMNs or the state-owned entities have the ability to restructure their loans. Then we've got to make sure that the larger corporations also can restructure their loans, because without restructuring, they're not going to be able to survive, because they need to pay the the principal and interest to the banks. They cannot as of today. I mean, some companies can't even pay THR, you know, and that is an unfortunate fact. In addition to all this restructuring activities on the supply side, people that actually recruit and empower people to a great scale, they need to be provided with working capital. So if you sum up the amount that's needed for the demand side, which is about 1,000 trillions for the next 6 months, if you sum up the amount that's needed on the supply side, which is about 2,000 trillions at least, you're looking at about 3,000 trillions. But of the 2,000 trillions, most of that is actually restructuring activity. So it's non-money. It doesn't require money. The part that requires money is the working capital. That's about 300 to 400 trillion rupees. So the actual printing of money is really not that much on the supply side, but I think it's a lot more on the demand side. Now, that's just to basically preserve life and livelihood without addressing our need to actually augment our competitive advantage, our marginal productivity, our basically. So if we were to try to get that kind of money, not enough money is in the country. And we're going to be squeezed with higher interest costs if we go out, you know, beyond the borders of Indonesia to borrow money. So you've got to print money. And if you print money, you've got to make sure that the interest rate is lower than before, because the small, the small medium entrepreneurs, they cannot shoulder the burden of high interest rates. So that's basically the pitch that I've been making to the people within the government. I'm sensing that I think they're moving closer and closer, inch by inch, to whatever, you know, I have been advocating and some other people have been advocating since March, but they're not there yet. So I'm hopeful that there's likely to be movement towards, you know, where we have been advocating.
Okay, Payudi. So Pagita, you're mentioning that one of the key factors of, you know, resolving conflict in the future is open-mindedness and the, you know, the bravery to try new things.
Correct.
Right.
Correct. I mean, you've got to be open-minded, you've got to be empathetic, and you've got to be proactive. And most failures in negotiations or showing leadership in negotiations of conflicts are related to the inability to be bold, the inability to be proactive, the inability to be empathetic, the inability to basically speak with the language of the counterpart. And right now, the counterpart is the people.
Yeah. Thank you, Pagita. Thank you, Pak.
Yeah.
Thank you, Payudi. So, Pagita, there's a question from one of our students, Boy Anugrah, but he cannot speak directly because there's a problem with his microphone. In regards to the leadership issue, does the background of a leader, for example, a leader from the military or civilian community, play an important role in decision-making process or managing conflict, given the fact that the discourse about leader and leadership in Indonesia, especially at the presidential level, there is always dichotomy between civilian and military and various other dichotomies. It's really different with the major states or major countries like the US or some European countries, in which idea and vision is the most important thing. Thank you very much.
Look, I think it's tempting to trust our instinct that people of military background are likely to be more decisive than people of non-military background or civilian background. But I'm not in that camp. I'm in the camp where I think anybody, despite or notwithstanding, their different backgrounds, I think could be, you know, decisive. And I think we've got a decisive leader in our country. But in the context of addressing the COVID-19 crisis, I can think of a number of countries' leaders that I think have shown real leadership decisive and wise leadership. One that, you know, sticks up in my head is the leadership of New Zealand. You know, Jacinda Ardern, the Prime Minister. I think she's been really cool-headed about, you know, many things. You know, at the outset of the crisis of shooting some time ago, she was very, very bold and decisive and basically, you know, controlling, you know, unique behavior on gun possessions. And, you know, they even legislated, you know, a legislation that would actually buy back, you know, the, you know, the personal possessions of guns and related items in a relatively quick period of time. And in the context of the COVID-19, she has been able to reach a level of no transmission, you know, just a week or two ago. And she has been able to show wisdom in basically showing support to all levels and all sectors of the economy. And, you know, if you saw 2 days ago, I mean, she was able to basically, you know, show support for people from the creative arts background. I've never heard of that stuff. You know, that stuff resonates with me because I come from that sort of a background, the creative arts. And I do believe that, you know, people of the creative arts background are some of the more sensitive or some of the more hard hit, you know, in COVID-19. And I'm quite surprised that most leaderships, they don't actually pay attention to that particular sector because they're actually a pretty contributive, you know, element of the society and the economic equation. So in essence, I think it's, you know, pretty agnostic in terms of where you come from, what sort of background you come from, in order to actually be bold and decisive and wise in coming up with a conflict resolution strategy.
Thank you, Pa. Pa Boy, I hope that answered your question. For the next questioner, Pa Gita, Naomi has a follow-up question. I mean, she asked about PE investment.
And I forgot about that. Yeah. Look, I've been saying this in a couple of other webinars. I think there is a trend, and it's a real trend, that companies that are trafficking in bytes are doing better during COVID and post-COVID than companies that are trafficking in atoms, okay? And unfortunately or fortunately, PE companies have largely been involved in companies or investing in companies that have been trafficking in atoms, right? These are bricks and mortars. And if you take a look at the valuations of companies in various capital markets around the world, those that are that have been trafficking in atoms have actually dwindled in values, whereas those companies that have been trafficking in bytes and that have been supported mostly by venture capital companies, they've actually been rising. Amazon, you know, rose by 20 to 30% in the last 3 months. Tesla, you know, rose, you know, a significant amount, 25 to 30%, you know, from the high of this year. A few months ago, towards the third quarter of last year, Tesla was trading at around $400. Now it's trading above $1,000. So these are actually companies that are trafficking in bytes. And I foresee a future where I think these companies are actually going to do even better than what we're seeing today. At the expense of, unfortunately, those that are trafficking in atoms, like hotels, like automotives with conventional wisdom, like factories of conventional wisdom. So it doesn't mean that the old paradigm cannot adjust. You know, I think you've got a real chance of adjusting by way of attaching digital capabilities to conventional wisdom. Even if, let's say, you're in agriculture, I think if you tweak that into, you know, organic production, and if you can actually engage, you know, digital capabilities for increasing your productivity, increasing your communication with the rest of the world, you have become a tech company. And you have become a company that traffics in bytes. If you are, you know, a manufacturer of cars, you've got to figure out a way to electrify yourselves. If you do not electrify yourselves, you're probably going to left in the woods. You saw that a few days ago. The market capitalization of Tesla has actually exceeded the market cap of the largest automotive company in the world called Toyota. And Toyota produces millions more cars than Tesla could do in a year. But the fact of the matter is there is a bigger recognition for companies that are actually likely to survive in the future because they are trafficking in bytes as opposed to atoms. So all this, I think, is going to affect the future of venture capital vis-a-vis private equity.
Thank you, Pak. So the contribution to economic growth or GDP growth will be minuscule if you know, the private equities keep doing the same thing in the past.
Correct. I foresee a future where private equity companies are actually going to divest from you know, investments that are not going to be able to make the adjustment to trafficking in bytes.
Okay, Pak Gita, thank you. But Naomi, I hope that answered your question. So there is one more question, Pak, from Mbak Ibe again. Indonesia has quite a good record for being a mediator for conflicts between countries. Unfortunately, Indonesia seems to have difficulty in negotiating with its own conflicts to other countries because we keep losing in our negotiations, such as negotiations about islands of Sipadan and Ligitan. Why do you think this is happening? With this fact, how certain are you that Indonesia can become the wise woman in this decoupling? Do we really have that ability?
Look, I've had some really remarkably good events of success in negotiating on behalf of others and also negotiating for ourselves. Okay. I don't mean to discount at all, you know, what we have achieved in the past. I think the future is only going to be brighter if we can actually get our act together in knowing more about, you know, the legal wisdom and other relevant technical wisdom. And I do believe that in order to promote our territorial integrity going forward, it requires a deep know-how of legal wisdom and hopefully legal maritime wisdom. And I you know, we saw expertise, you know, being projected through the SGPP webinar a few days ago, you know, with regards to the maritime affairs. And I think that is one example of how we could actually improve ourselves with respect to maritime affairs. But it can be enriched with, I think, a deeper, you know, base of legal wisdom, so that we can, you know, when we enter into international communication that would involve other neighboring countries or beyond, we could actually utter our stance in a much more coherent manner, in a much more bold and decisive manner. And I think that's only likely to be resulting in greater visibility about where we are and where we want to be, number one. Number two, you know, as much as we want to basically expand our legal and maritime wisdom, we've got to be able to expand our economic and entrepreneurial wisdom. Because at the end of the day, you know, we're not going to be able to grow as exponentially as we would until and unless we can actually grow our fiscal space. Our fiscal space is still inhibited to some extent. because of the fact that our tax ratio is still at around 10 to 11% of our GDP. That does not compare favorably with, OECD countries, which are at, tax ratios of 30% or above. That does not compare favorably with tax ratios of some neighboring countries or some Asia Pacific countries. So to the extent that we can ramp up our tax ratio from 10 or 11% of the GDP to a much larger, then we have a much deeper pocket. We have a much bigger wallet to spend on where we want to basically get our next generations of Indonesians to be knowledgeable and wise in. And I've said this over and over like a broken record that I think we've got to improve upon our empirical science base. I think we are great at social sciences, but I think we could be and we need to be better and much more in scale in empirical science. That's where I think the money needs to go to in the future, so that once we can improve upon our empirical science, we can actually project our narrative a lot better to the rest of the world, that we're open for business for things that are actually at the higher levels of the value chain. Not just, those that are digging the ground, those that are stitching, the clothes at a factory or the shoes at the factory, but, it needs to involve people that can actually code, that can actually program, that can actually, do artificial intelligence or data analytics that I think could be adding a lot more value to not only the business enterprise, but also adding a lot more value to the fiscal space at the end of the day. When that happens, I think we've got a much more complete picture of a beautiful Indonesia.
Thank you, Pagita. So, are there any more questions, guys? Okay. So, Pagita, this is actually going to be our last week for this semester. Next week okay. will be our final exams. And so, this is perhaps the last interaction, in the classroom with this batch. So, we'll still be having, you can still come, in our next webinars for the next batches, of course. But so this is going to be your last session with Pagita formally in this batch. So once again, thank you very much, Pagita, for your time.
I just wanna basically, share with all of us that, it's been tough for everyone around the world. The last 3 to 4 months, and the way the virus has affected all of us has been so completely non-discriminatory, with total disregard of race, religion, ethnic background, color of skin, power, strength, financial strength, or whatever attribute it could be, and the fact that it has come at such a surprising rate, speed, and whatever, it has collapsed, the way of thinking for most people. And I just would encourage and urge everyone to stay vigilant. And I think the only way for all of us to survive is to show adaptability. Adaptability, I think, will take us to the next level. And this is not unprecedented, because Indonesia has gone through crises of large scales in the past 2,000 years. And it's nothing like, we're learning. We've always been learning from every crisis that we've confronted. And I do smell a future where there might be, a further equalization of humanity because of maybe, the recognition that it's not going to be sustainable if we keep or maintain the way of thinking. And at the rate that we can actually change the way that we think, I think there's hope that the world could be a better place. And as much as people think that this is really stormy, I've been saying in other, you know, webinars that, you know, this could be the storm before the calm. And I think the calm is going to be reflecting or reflected, you know, in how we could actually appreciate each other better and how we can actually usher equality a little bit better. So that, you know, democracy could actually sustain, you know, in a long period of time. So those of us that are not going to, you know, have an easy time adjusting, be it to the digitization, be it to the virtualization, be it to anything that's going to entail adaptability, I know it's going to be tough, but you just got to keep trying. And we have experienced, I think, in the last 3 months, you know, fatality or death, you know, at least within 2 degrees of freedom. You know, I've had deaths, you know, involving, you know, a colleague of a friend of a colleague, a friend of a relative, a relative of a relative, or a friend of a friend, or a friend of a friend of a friend. These are, you know, fatalities that, you know, I did not expect to happen in the last 3 months. And I hope that, you know, you do not feel uniquely, you know, treated. It is pretty non-discriminatory. And I think we've just got to be able to figure out a way to adapt a little bit better. And I'm optimistic that if we show that kind of wisdom, that kind of pragmatism, I think we could look pretty okay. And I wish all of you health and success in whatever you're doing.
Thank you, Pagita. Pagita, before we leave, I'd like to invite everyone to have, you know, to turn on their videos so that I can take a screenshot of everyone here, and then I can share it with everyone later on. Take a selfie together, but virtually. Okay, guys,
and don't forget to read the strategic review. I know it's a tough read, but I know some of you don't like to read, but you know, just spend time reading. And if you need to sleep a little bit more easily at night, just read the first paragraph of strategic review. Then I guarantee you, you'll fall asleep.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Yes.
I like to read, but I don't like to write.
You don't like to write? Okay. Neither do I. But I've written quite a few.
Okay, guys, so could you turn on your videos so that I can take a picture? For those of you guys who have videos. Okay, Mas Jafar, Mas Alam, Mas Ardi, Mas Boy. Okay. Zaki. Okay, ready, guys? Okay, I'm assuming that. Okay. I'm going to take the picture now. 1, 2, 3. Okay, another one. 1, 2, 3. Okay. So the next page. 1, 2, 3. Okay, I guess that's it, guys. Pagita, once again, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
It's always a pleasure to have you with us.
Okay.
Thank you, Pagita.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thanks.
Thank you, Pagita.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pagita.
Bye, Pa.
And thank you, guys, for joining us. Well, we'll still be meeting each other. In other occasions, hopefully. And please work on your thesis. That's the last message. I know it's tough. I know it's, you know, the conditions, the circumstances are not ideal, but yeah, we work with what we have. Okay, guys, I'll see you again soon. Thank you very much.